Muscle injuries, like tendon injuries and ligament injuries, are really common among athletes across lots of different sports, and they can lead to significant morbidity and loss of playing time. In this lecture, we'll be looking at the pattern of injury occurrence, risk factors, underlying mechanisms, clinical features, diagnostic methods, and treatment approaches for muscle injuries.
The incidence of muscle injuries varies across sports, ages, genders, and competition levels. Certain sports like soccer, track and field, and gymnastics have a higher prevalence, probably because of their strenuous physical demands. Likewise, male athletes tend to have a higher incidence rate of muscle injuries compared to their female counterparts, although the disparity is less pronounced in non-contact sports. Notably, the risk of muscle injuries tends to increase with age, highlighting the role of physiological changes and accumulated wear and tear on muscle health.
Lots of different modifiable and non-modifiable variables contribute to the overall risk of muscle injury. One of the challenges in narrowing down and consolidating these risk factors is caused by the lack of prospective studies looking at how muscle injuries develop in different sports and populations, or randomized control trials evaluating the best methods for reducing this risk. Despite this, though, the available research does point to certain modifiable risk factors, things like not warming up sufficiently, increasing your training load too quickly, training or competing while fatigued, or having certain strength imbalances between muscle groups. Similarly, certain non-modifiable risk factors, like having a previous muscle injury or being older, make you more likely to sustain an injury in the future.
A previous muscle injury is a recurrently noted risk factor for future injuries. Research involving lots of different sports consistently highlights that athletes with a history of muscle injuries are 2 to 6 times more likely to suffer a re-injury. Most recurrent injuries happen within the first few months of return to sport, but the elevated risk persists over time. For example, some studies have found that an athlete with a previous history of muscle injury has up to 3 times that of a non-injured athlete, and that this persists for up to a year or longer post the initial injury. The heightened risk associated with previous injury is thought to be due in part to residual muscle weakness or altered neuromuscular control, which can last up to several months according to some laboratory and clinical studies. But the role of inadequate rehabilitation, premature return to sport, and permanent tissue damage resulting from the initial injury are topics of ongoing debate. One of the most commonly held ideas is that inflexibility in certain muscles may increase the risk of certain injuries, but the evidence isn't exactly clear on this, with some research both supporting and refuting the notion. One of the issues is that it's actually quite hard to accurately measure the flexibility of muscle groups, never mind individual muscles. For example, defining flexibility in the quads can be tricky, as one of the muscles in this group, the rectus femoris specifically, is biarticular. It crosses 2 joints, so isolating it with one specific flexibility test is hard. The other issue is that greater flexibility might indeed be protective for some muscles, but may actually increase risk for others. It's probably the case that flexibility plays some role in injury risk, but this role is sport, playstyle, and person specific. There is also probably some optimal relationship between antagonistic muscle groups like the quads and hamstrings, or the pectoral girdle and the rotator cuff, but research is equivocal about this.
This also applies to the case of muscle weakness. Significant muscle weakness, whether relative to the contralateral muscle group or the agonist-antagonist muscle group, as well as absolute muscle weakness, has been shown to potentially increase the risk of muscle injury.
For example, a study of rugby athletes found that differences in eccentric strength between legs of more than 15% significantly increased the risk of muscle injury, 2.4-fold, while a 20% difference led to a 3.4-fold increase. Similarly, in a study of elite soccer players, those with eccentric strength below a certain threshold, as determined during pre-season training, were more likely to sustain a muscle strain.
All of this feeds into the kinetic chain theory, whereby muscles act as one component in a series of interconnected musculoskeletal structures that coordinate and control movement. This theory posits that a muscle is an integral structure in this chain, and any weakness or tightness, any part of the kinetic chain, increases the strain placed on other components, which must compensate, thereby increasing their risk of injury.
For instance, some research has shown that an injury in a certain muscle or muscle group can alter an athlete's biomechanics, and this places increased stress on other muscles elsewhere in that kinetic chain. The trouble here, again, is that research is equivocal and very difficult to do, but some observational studies have found that the risk of subsequent muscle injury is increased in individuals with a history of certain joint or muscle injuries elsewhere in the kinetic chain. While the age ranges of athletes involved in studies of muscle injuries is often narrow, increasing age seems to be a potential risk factor for such injuries, according to multiple studies. Specifically, some research has shown that athletes over the age of 23 are between 1.3 to 3.9 times more likely to sustain a muscle injury than younger players, while athletes over 25 are 2.8 to 4.4 times more likely.
Several theories have been proposed to explain why muscle injury risk increases with age. One theory suggests that aging correlates with a reduction in muscle cross-sectional area, reducing the muscle's capacity to generate tension and resist loads before failure. But the studies supporting this theory often involved younger athletes who may not have fully developed musculature, and older athletes who may have already suffered subclinical muscle injuries. Another theory specific to the hamstring muscle group is that age-related lumbar degeneration leads to L5 and S1 nerve impingement, and this subsequently leads to hamstring muscle fiber degeneration and ultimately hamstring injury. The important thing to take from this is that there are lots of different risk factors. Age, strength, inflexibility, and previous injuries are just a few. There are lots of potential other ones, and these likely vary depending on the sport and the individual. We've already mentioned how muscle injuries are more frequently seen in sports that incorporate high-speed running or changes in direction like track and field, American football, or soccer. There are also probably lots of other risk factors which we haven't talked about, or which there is just very little research for, things like nutrition or your diet, your behavior, and genetic factors are obvious ones too. When it comes to the types of muscle injuries, the Munich Consensus Statement presents a nice way to categorize the different kinds of muscle injuries and how they develop.
It categorizes muscle injuries into three main groups: functional muscle disorders, structural muscle injuries, and complications. Functional muscle disorders are further divided into fatigue-induced muscle disorders, delayed onset muscle soreness, or DOMS, and neuromuscular muscle disorders. While structural injuries are classified based on their nature and extent into partial muscle tears, sub or total muscle tears, and tendinous avulsions, where the origin or insertion of the muscle is torn, are included under this classification. Finally, we have muscle contusions. These are caused by external forces, like a direct blow, leading to defined blunt trauma and associated hematoma. They can range from mild to severe, depending on the contact force and the contraction state of the affected muscle at the moment of injury.
The evaluation and diagnosis of muscle injuries involves a comprehensive examination, which includes understanding the history and mechanism of injury, performing a thorough physical examination, pinpointing the location of injury, and deploying appropriate diagnostic imaging techniques.
Understanding the history of injury, how it happened, is vital, as individuals with muscle injuries typically present with sudden pain onset during activities that put high strain on the muscles. They might report a pop or localized warmth at the injury site. For example, the two main mechanisms for thigh muscle injuries are a high-speed mechanism, often seen during fast movements like running, and a low-speed mechanism, which occurs during stretching movements that force the muscle beyond its elastic capabilities. Next, the physical examination. This typically follows a standard approach of inspection, palpation, range of motion assessment, strength testing, and special testing. Visual inspection involves checking for gait abnormalities, swelling, ecchymosis, muscular defects, and atrophy. Palpation of the affected muscle from origin to insertion, particularly at key points, often reveals focal tenderness. The evaluation of range of motion and strength, typically performed with the patient in various positions, can reveal significant differences between the affected and unaffected muscles. All of this information comes together to inform how the healthcare professional grades the severity of the injury and their treatment plan. Diagnostic imaging, too, often plays an important role in assessing muscle injuries. Musculoskeletal ultrasonography and magnetic resonance imaging can be used to provide detailed information about the location and extent of the injury. Ultrasonography has the advantage of low cost, portability, and the ability to perform dynamic assessments, though its accuracy depends on the skill of the ultrasonographer. MRI, on the other hand, provides more reliable assessments for tendon and osseous avulsion injuries and injuries at the deeper musculotendinous junction, but is more costly. When severe injuries are suspected, MRI is usually the modality of choice. Regardless, neither ultrasound nor MRI has shown strong efficacy for estimating overall recovery time.
Muscle injuries often require specific treatment methods that can range from simple rest to complex surgical procedures. The quality of evidence that guides these interventions is quite variable, though. Many treatment approaches are based on small case studies or clinical experience, but there are an increasing number of randomized control trials in the field of muscle injury research.
In the acute phase of injury, the protection, rest, ice, compression, elevation, or PRICE protocol is often the first line of treatment for acute muscle strains. The overall goal being to limit bleeding, swelling, and pain just after the injury has occurred. Non-prescription analgesics like ibuprofen or acetaminophen are sometimes used for pain relief, but there's a lack of definitive evidence regarding the efficacy of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, or NSAIDs, in the treatment of muscle injuries, and there are concerns about their potential to delay healing or weaken tissues on the long run. There are also lots of other treatment modalities that are sometimes used, like glucocorticoid or platelet-rich plasma injections, low-intensity pulsed ultrasound, therapeutic laser, electrical stimulation, massage, and extracorporeal shockwave therapy. We don't have time to go into all of these, but in short, the evidence supporting their use is limited and conflicting. Glucocorticoid injections, in particular, are generally not recommended because of their potential catabolic effects on muscle and the absence of compelling evidence supporting their benefits. But exceptions might be made for elite or professional athletes who are in competition, under the supervision of experienced sports medicine physicians.
The core tenet of rehabilitation, though, involves a structured program that encompasses multiplanar movements, exercises to enhance trunk stability and proprioception, agility training, eccentric strength exercises for the injured muscle, and sport-specific drills. This is where there is lots of good research. Several randomized control trials have demonstrated the efficacy of certain exercises and rehabilitation protocols. We won't go into detail on these here, but there are links to a few examples in the description below.